Welcome to worship at Ridley Park Presbyterian Church. Glad that you're here, and pray that you will sense God's presence and be encouraged and challenged in your relationship with Him because you are here or because you are watching this service. A few announcements as we begin. The first, the Alpha course is starting. Oh, wait. I'm not supposed to be here. I'm going to change it. The Alpha course is starting. Do you want to know more about the Alpha course? Stay there. You know, back during those days when we were recording our services, I could do the sermon in one take almost every time. The announcements, 12, 15 takes. Oh, and it's still true. Anyway, Alpha, a wonderful opportunity to share the Christian message in a non-threatening way, in a way that people are encouraged to ask any questions they might have. The videos are excellent. The fellowship is wonderful. It starts out at 6 o'clock with dinner, and then it moves into the video presentation and then the discussion. It is a great course, and we encourage you, if you'd like a refresher on your faith, or if you know someone who could really be, who needs to know more, invite them. Alpha here begins on September 18th and runs for 11 weeks. I want to take this opportunity to welcome any visitors who might be with us this morning. We do have visitor cards in the pew racks in front of you, and it's very wonderful to have you fill those out so that we know who you are and can maybe send a letter out to you and just hopefully get to know you better. So we do welcome you and are glad that you are here with us today. If you have visited with us before but haven't filled out one of those cards, please do so this morning. Remember last week when I said this week was when we were having our fall kickoff? I said maybe we should have just played the recording of the service because it actually is next week. Now, rather than never. Next week, fall kickoff picnic, right after the worship service. Worship service still at 10 o'clock next week, a blended service. And then we'll go, the kids will come in and share a song with us, and then they'll go out for their festivities, and then we'll join festivities after worship with our picnic after the worship service. And after that, then, on the 17th, we'll be going back to our two-service schedule with 9 o'clock contemporary worship and 11 o'clock traditional worship. We're also beginning an adult study on that Sunday, looking at one at a time Kyle Eidelman's study of the life of Jesus and how he impacted people for the kingdom of God, one person at a time, and calls us to do the same. Grief Share is also starting up. And that will be on Tuesday, September 12th, and they also meet at 6 p.m. in the church parlor. If you're interested in learning more about them, there are brochures located around the room. And finally, St. Catherine Drexel has reopened. We're glad to know that and glad to assist them in their ministry. So not tomorrow, but next Monday is when we will be delivering peanut butter and jelly sandwiches to them. So if you can help out, please go on the church website and click reach out, and there is a place for you to click that you can make peanut butter and jelly sandwiches, and you'll find directions as to how to make them if you don't know, right there on that page, and then maybe an email will come to you as well. Let us pray together. Lord God, we think about that song that was played, "You Are Truly Great." We know that, but we don't know how great. Help us to, every day of our lives, grow to know your greatness more and more, to understand who you are, so that we then understand the greatness of your love for us, how amazing your grace truly is for us. I pray that by the power and presence of your Holy Spirit, you would interact with us this day to draw us closer to you. Help us to know your grace, your love for us and for those around us in the world, that we might share the ministry of reconciliation that has been opened to us. You reconciled to us through the work of Jesus Christ, and then us sharing this truth with the world. Equip us for this, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Oh,
Please be seated and join me in the responsive reading of Psalm 51. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love. Wash away all my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin, for I know my transgression and my sin is always before me.
Against you, you only, have I sinned, and done what is evil in your sight. Sin your right in your verdict, and justify and judge.
Surely I was sinful at birth, sinful from the time my mother conceived me. Cleanse me with hyssop, and I will be clean. Wash me, and I will be whiter than snow. Let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones you have crushed rejoice. Create in me a pure heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me from your presence or take your Holy Spirit from me. You do not delight in sacrifice, or I would bring it. You do not take pleasure in burnt offerings.
Bye. in his flesh and bone, crying out to you, Lord, I'm desperate. Love, come rattle this cage and set me free. All of my fears fight, the Jericho walls gotta come down, come down. All of my fears fight, the Jericho walls gotta come down, come down. Oh Lord, my prison turns to ruin when your love moves in. All of my fears fight, the Jericho walls gotta come down, come down, come down. In your flesh and bone, the wounds that have set my soul forgiven. Oh, now I can feel the darkness trembling. All of my fears, the Jericho walls gotta come down, come down. All of my fears, the Jericho walls gotta come down, come down. Oh Lord, my prison turns to ruin when your love moves. Repel me from the ground up. All I want to see is you. Terrify the lies with truth. All of my fears fight. Jericho walls gotta come down, come down. All of my fears fight. Jericho walls gotta come down, come down. My prison turns to ruin when your love moves in. All of my fears fight. Jericho walls gotta come down, come down, come down. Jericho walls gotta come down, come down, come down.
Hey kids, come on up. This is.
What is it? Say it louder. Coca-Cola. Yes, it's Coca-Cola. Anybody thirsty? I'm not going to give it to you. All right, do something for me. I can see, I want you to change yourselves around. All the people that are in the back, come up to the front. Come on up, girls. Come on up closer so you can see over the other people. Hey, other people, let the smaller ones see over top of you. Know what I mean? That's cool. Good job. Okay, so, what do you think's gonna happen? Maybe I'll hold on to this. Oops, it's not gonna work on the microphone.
Maybe you guys should hold on to this. Who's gonna hold on to this? Maybe hold it out a little.
Zoe, will you hold my microphone for a minute?
Ready? Set?
What happened? What was supposed to happen? Was supposed to explode all over, all the way back to like Pastor Jim. It was gonna be so much fun. Know why it didn't explode? It's water with food coloring. It's fake. It's not the real thing. You know what? Sometimes when we come to church on Sunday, we might be kind of faking it a little bit. Acting nicer and kinder and generouser than we are. We might be going to school or our sports games or things like that, or even home with our families, and we're not as kind, or we're not as sweet, or we're not as helpful as we could be. And you know what makes a difference? Jesus in our heart makes the difference. If you have Jesus in your heart, if you've said, Jesus, please come into my heart and be my Savior, he makes all the difference in the world, and he helps us to be the real thing and to not be fake when we're in school, when we're at home, when we're out playing with our friends. And then we can tell our friends about Jesus too, and that's really special. Let's pray. Dear Jesus, thank you that you are so real to us, and you can be real to anybody, no matter if we're 1 year old or 100 years old. You are with us if we ask you to be. Thank you for each of these children, and I pray that they will continue to learn about you. Help Sunday school to be great today, and that they'll learn even more. In Jesus' name, amen. And if you don't know what I'm talking about with Jesus in your heart, ask your Sunday school teachers, ask Dave, ask Pastor Jim, ask me, and we will explain it to you. All right. Your dinosaur. Thank you for the dinosaur, Luke. Have a great time in Sunday school, guys.
Pray with me. Lord God, we thank you that you are indeed the real thing. That when you enter our lives, your Spirit works in us to change us, to give us vitality, to give us new life, abundant life, eternal life, those qualities of life that make us different from the world around us. And Lord, as we have looked at the book of Romans, we've seen what Jesus Christ has done for us in the first 12 chapters, and now, the first 11 chapters, and now as we looked at 12 and now 13, we see how we are to respond, how we are to work, to allow your Spirit to change us, to move within us, to make us different kinds of people than we were before, and different kinds of people than the people around us who don't know you. So I pray that by the power and presence of your Holy Spirit, you would work through this word today, by the power and presence of your Spirit once again, to change us, to change our minds, to change our hearts, to change our attitudes, that we might be people who truly reflect you and your heart for the world. We humble ourselves before you now. And we pray that you would identify any ideas or any thoughts or any patterns in us that are contrary to your word, and that you would replace those with your truth, with your will, with your plans and purposes for us. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Romans 13, 1 through 10. Let everyone be subject to governing authorities. For there is no authority except that which God has established. The authorities that exist have been established by God. Consequently, whoever rebels against the authority is rebelling against what God has instituted. And those who do so will bring judgment on themselves. For rulers hold no terror for those who do right, but for those who do wrong. Do you want to be free from fear and the one in authority? Then do what is right, and you will be commended. For the one authority is God's. For the one in authority is God's servant for your good. But if you do wrong, be afraid. For rulers do not bear the sword for no reason. They are God's servants, agents of wrath to bring punishment on the wrongdoer. Therefore, it is necessary to submit to the authorities, not only because of possible punishment, but also as a matter of conscience. This is also why you pay taxes, for the authorities are God's servants who give their full time to governing. Give to everyone what you owe them. If you owe taxes, pay taxes. If revenue, then revenue. If respect, then respect. If honor, then honor. Let no debt remain outstanding except the continuing debt to love one another. For whoever loves others has fulfilled the law. The commandments, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not covet. And whatever other commands there may be are summed up in this one command. Love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no harm to a neighbor. Therefore, love is the fulfillment of the law. This passage is a vitally important passage for those of us who live today where we live. For there are strong influencers trying to convince us that we should work against the government, that those who are Christians, especially because we answer to God, don't need to answer to the government. But Paul says the opposite, and Paul's words are inspired by God. This is Scripture. Those other voices do not speak for God, but Paul does. So we need to wrestle with this truth. First off, I just want to remind us that chapters 1 through 11 of the book of Romans, Paul talked about how magnificent, how amazing it is that we have received salvation, that we have received new life in Jesus Christ, and that therefore our lives are different than the lives of the world around us. At the end, though, of last week's passage, it says, "Do not take revenge, my dear friends, for vengeance is mine, says the Lord." So some might say, well, then are we supposed to live in anarchy when everyone can get away with anything they want to do? And in chapter 13, he addresses that to at least a degree, where he says the government is charged with punishing those who disobey the law. The government is charged with keeping authority, maintaining order in this world, and God has entrusted them to punish when punishment is due. And that's very clear here. Paul says, God has established the rulers. God has established the concept of government, that there would be people over other people with authority, and these people with authority would make laws and guide the whole population, each population with its own rulers, and each population submitting to the rulers that are in place in their land. And then it even goes on to say that each individual ruler is appointed by God. And we would say, what? We've seen some very godless rulers. We have seen rulers who do not care one bit about God. And it says here that God has appointed them. And this is a great, I have to admit, this is a bit of a mystery for me. I can't fully grasp this, but Andy Stanley in a sermon on this passage says that we don't know what God is doing. God has a bigger plan. So it will be mysterious for us, but God is working out God's bigger plan. And sometimes that means that there will be people in power that do not do godly things. And our response should be to submit. In verse 1, let everyone be subject And in verse 5, it is necessary to submit to the authorities. It's the same word that is used, and that word is hupotasso. And I've spoken about that word before, hupo meaning under, and tasso to line up or to support. So the idea is that Christians should be people who support our governments. That doesn't mean that we agree with everything the government does or says or stands for, but that we are good citizens. Now, as I said, there is a strong movement away from this idea. It used to be, as in our country, that there was an overall understanding that we at least respect the office, even if we can't respect the person. But today, as one person wrote, we make sport of being disagreeable, angry, and speaking evil of one another, particularly leaders. And I've heard it even within these walls. There is sort of an agreed upon understanding among American citizens that we criticize the government at every opportunity, that we have this underlying distrust in everything they do, and we like it when we can talk about it and say, oh yeah, those people. When we do that, friends, we're disobeying God. We are questioning God. And we are sinning. Now, you may question Paul as he writes this. Paul, come on. You don't know what it's like. You don't know what it's like to have so-and-so as president. You don't know what it's like to have the other so-and-so as president. Paul might say no. But I know what it's like to have Nero as emperor. I know what it's like to have Gaius, who's also known as Caligula, as emperor. Caligula preceded Nero. Caligula, there was a movie about him way back. He's just a really nasty guy. He had his family members killed so that they wouldn't try to gain authority over him. His wife died, so he found a boy that looked sort of like her, had him castrated and dressed him up as in his wife's clothes and married him. He appointed his horse to a governing body just because he could. Now, that's really weird. And the poor horse, he could never vote yes for anything. Every time the vote came up, his answer was nay. I stole that from J.D. Greer, who thought it wasn't funny. I think it is. By the way, J.D. Greer has a great series on Romans, and I'm using that a lot. It's found on Right Now Media. If you don't have a subscription, email the church office, and we will make sure you get one. It is free. Caligula, Gaius, would take the heads off of the statues of the Roman gods and put an image of his own head up there. Can you imagine? A president who would paste his picture over the picture of Jesus? He went to the temple to sacrifice a bull. He went in with the priest. And with the mallet in his hand that he was going to use to kill the bull, he hit the head of the priest, and the priest lay there dying, and Caligula laughed at him as he died. It was into this context that Paul said, submit to your governing authorities. Nero set the city on fire and blamed the Christians. He saw Christians as enemies. And many commentators believe that Paul, in writing this, intended for Nero to get his hands on it and to see that Christians were not a threat, that Christians were, as people who trust God, to be good citizens no matter what the government was like. God has established government, and Christians are called to support hupotasso, the government. So if ever I read you saying on social media, or I hear you say the words, so-and-so is not my president, it grieves me deeply. Because you're adopting the value system of the world, and you are rejecting the Word of God. The Word of God says, support your governing authorities. These words were written through Jeremiah, the prophet, at a time when Israel was in exile and the leaders over them, the leaders under whom they've been placed, were not godly leaders. There is no assumption in Scripture that our leaders will share our faith, to share our commitment to honoring God. But the direction that we are given is found here in Jeremiah 29, 4 through 9. This is what the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says to all those I carried into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon. Build houses and settle down. Plant gardens and eat what they produce. Marry and have sons and daughters. Find wives for your sons and give your daughters in marriage so that they too may have sons and daughters. Increase in number there, do not decrease. Also, seek the peace and prosperity of the city to which I have carried you into exile. Seek the peace and prosperity of the city into which I have called you into exile. Pray to the Lord for it, because if it prospers, you too will prosper. Yes, this is what the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says. Do not let the prophets and diviners among you deceive you. I might say, do not let the pundits deceive you. Do not let those who claim to know what it means to be a Christian in our society deceive you if they do not share the message of Scripture, which is to support governing authorities. Do not listen to the dreams you encourage them to have. They are prophesying lies to you in my name. I have not sent them, declares the Lord. Jeremiah gives us a few guidelines for how we are to behave, including just seek the peace and prosperity of our community, of our state, of our nation. Pray for those who are in authority. And in our situation where we live in a democracy, we are to vote. It is shameful that Christians wouldn't vote. We have, that is the power we've been given to guide the nation into godliness as much as we can, into peace and prosperity. And then, pay your taxes. Verse 6, this is also why you pay taxes. I know a number of Christians who are very committed to paying as little tax as possible, to taking payment under the table so that the government doesn't see, because they don't trust the government to use their money well. So why should they give the government their money? Well, because Paul, inspired by the Holy Spirit, says, pay your taxes. And Paul wasn't the only one. Jesus was confronted by the Pharisees who asked him, now should we pay taxes to Caesar? They had this same underlying assumption that many people today have, is that, well, the government's bad, so should we even support them? If we're going to be godly people, how can we support an ungodly government? And Jesus says, bring me your coin. Whose image is on the coin? And the government leader's image is on the coin. Jesus says, if Caesar's image is on the coin, give to Caesar what is Caesar's. and give to God what is God's. This attitude of withholding money, or this attitude of holding on to money, is an attitude that is an expression of distrust in God's provision. It's an attitude that says, what's mine is mine and I must keep it, rather than what's mine has been entrusted to me by God so that I can bless others and God will continue to bless me. Caesar's face is on the money. Our government insignias and faces are on our money. So it is, in that sense, appropriate for us to give to the government what is the government's, whether we like it or not, whether we think it's fair or not. Because doing so expresses two things. It expresses our willingness to abide by God's principle that we support and encourage and seek the peace and prosperity of our governing authorities. And it also is an expression of our faith and trust in God's ongoing provision. And as Caesar's face is on the money, God's image is in you. You belong to God. Charles Stanley in a sermon, his son, Andy Stanley, in a sermon on this passage says it's, and he applies this not just to governing authorities, but to bosses, to employers. He says, they might ask you to do something you think is utterly idiotic. And many of us might decide to do it, but make sure we do some other things to make it fail so that they can see how stupid they are. He said, don't do that, because they have been placed in authority. Don't consider the what, but the who. And the who God has placed there. And all of this is founded on the foundation of love. We are to love the world, all people. God says that love is the foundational commandment, as we see in verse 9. All these commandments about not committing adultery, not murdering, not stealing, not coveting, whatever other command there may be, they're summed up in this one: love your neighbor as yourself. And we've been looking at that through Romans, that being in Christ means that we shift away from the natural human tendency to focus on ourselves, to want what we want, to make sure we get what we want, and to devalue others. But the Christian value is to value others, even above ourselves, to seek their good, to be humble. And I think it's important, as many of the sermons I read for this and commentators, to remember God is more concerned with your character than he is with your rights. That is a hard word to hear in 21st century United States of America, because we are all about our rights. But God, in placing us under authority, says you will have to humble yourself, and in so doing, your character will be built. And you will have what you believe is your natural rights violated as your character is being built. Now, I'm not saying that we allow horrible things to happen to ourselves or others. And there are many arguments with this passage where trying to figure out, well, what's the limit of this? And Paul doesn't address that, so I'm not going to address that here. What I'm really hoping to achieve through this sermon is an attitude shift, a a seismic attitude shift for some, from a disdain and distrust and hatred for the government to an attitude of support, an attitude of prayer, an attitude of hupotasso, undergirding and seeking the flourishing of our land. And we do this because we are followers of Jesus Christ. John Piper says it this way: we are a people of the cross. Our Lord submitted to crucifixion, willingly to save his enemies, his enemies. We owe our eternal life to him. We are forgiven sinners. This takes the swagger out of our protest. It takes the arrogance out of our resistance. If we must disobey, we will first take the log from our own eye, which will lead us to soften our imagination into a humble, quiet, but unshakable no. The greatest battle we face is not overcoming unjust laws, but becoming Christ-like people. J.D. Greer says, don't give your primary trust to an elephant or to a donkey, but to the Lamb, because our salvation will never arrive on Air Force One. Our salvation is in Jesus Christ, and his kingdom will ultimately reign. He will ultimately reign over all, and all will be finally just and right. In the meantime, we subject ourselves to the authorities that God has put in place. And finally, from 1 Peter, you are a chosen people. You are a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. Once you were not a people, but now you are the people of God. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. Dear friends, I urge you as foreigners and exiles to abstain from sinful desires which war against your soul. Live such good lives among the pagans that though they accuse you of wrongdoing, they may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day he visits us. Submit yourselves for the Lord's sake to every human authority, whether to the emperor as the supreme authority, or to governors who are sent by him to punish those who do wrong and to commend those who do right. For it is God's will that by doing good you should silence the ignorant talk of foolish people. Live as free people, but do not use your freedom as a cover-up for evil. Live as God's servants. Show proper respect to everyone. Love the family of believers. Fear God. Honor the emperor. Let us pray. Lord God, we thank you for the salvation that is ours in Jesus Christ. We are humbled by your grace, and yet usually not humbled enough. For pride still gets its talons into us. We think we know better. We act superior. And we fail to love as you love. Help us, Lord God, to love because we have been loved. Help us to trust that you are at work even when the circumstances make it seem like you're not, so that we can live lives that give honor and glory to you and support those around us. Strengthen us, we pray, for your service. And we pray, thanking you, that at this table, your Holy Spirit is at work. At this table, you nourish us by the power and presence of your Holy Spirit. So we pray that this bread may be for us the body of Christ, that we may then be strengthened to be the body of Christ in this world. and that the cup may be for us the blood of Christ coursing new life through our bodies, through our veins, that we would be characterized by your life, by eternal life, by eternal values. We pray that you would be at work in us. And we pray this confidently because we pray in the power of Jesus' name and by the presence of your Holy Spirit. Amen. Can I get some help to pull this out? Yeah, I guess we got to go up a little. Thank you. Yep, perfect. As we receive these elements, I encourage you to hold the bread until all have received. And then we will partake of the bread together as a symbol that we are together the body of Christ. And then afterwards, as you receive the cup, you may drink that as an individual, symbolizing that we are each individually part of that body of Jesus Christ, and each have a relationship with him. On the night that he was betrayed, Jesus took bread and he broke it, and he said, "This is my body. It's broken for you. Take it and eat it, every one of you, remembering me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and he said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Every one of you, drink it, remembering me." The Apostle Paul said, "Every time we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the death of the Lord Jesus Christ until he comes again." Jesus said, "Take and eat, remembering me." That same night after supper, Jesus took the cup and he said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Take it and drink it, every one of you, remembering me." Let us pray the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
This great unknown,
Questions come and questions go. Was there purpose for the pain? Did I cry these tears in vain? I don't want to live in fear. I want to trust that you are near. Trust your grace can be seen in both triumph and tragedy.
As we close, I want to remind you that we do have a prayer page that is sent out each week with the other information. I encourage you to use that to pray for the people of our church who have requested prayer for guidance in praying for our nation and our rulers, our governing authorities, for our mission partners, etc. And today I just want to bring up a few things that I would ask you for prayer. One is the Jennings family upon the death of Jen's brother George last Sunday, for Dave Hartzell and his family upon the death of his mother on Thursday. And we celebrate new life, the birth of John Edward Goodman IV, grandson of John Edward Goodman Jr., who is standing at the back of the sanctuary, and we celebrate with him. And John IV was born on the birthday of John Sr., who was his great-grandfather. So a beautiful thing happened yesterday, was it? Yesterday. So we celebrate with you, John. And now may God himself, the God of peace, sanctify you through and through. May your whole soul, spirit, and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. The one who has called you is faithful, and he will do this. Amen.